you so much for attending tonight. As Ms. Wang mentioned, my name is Catherine M. Walter, and I am the curator here at the Livingston Masonic Library. Thank you for coming to hear about one of the amazing stories that I uncovered while working with the Livingston Masonic Library of Grand Lodge of New York's artifact collection. There are over 50,000 items in the museum collection, and until a specific item is researched, it's often not evident why it or the items related to it are in the collection. The discovery of the history associated with these artifacts is often a path of discovery that brings me to all parts of the library's collections, including the books, the archives, and the artifacts. While modern donations to the collection are focused more on the individual Mason, much of the early core collection was donated because of more widespread historic significance. However, much of this history has been lost to the veil of time. A wonderful part of my position here is bringing of this history back into the minds of our current membership and patron base. The long-forgotten story I'll be telling tonight began with a cryptic message that caught my eye. In 2006, while working with the postcard collection, within which there are over 6,000 postcards, I came across one with a reproduction of a painting by M.A. Rasko of Lasdon Kossuth, or Louis Kossuth, as he is known in English. Lasdon Kossuth was the hero of the 1848 Hungarian Revolution for Freedom and has been called Hungary's George Washington. The postcard was addressed to Mr. and Mrs. Morris Cooker, who lived here in Manhattan, and it was sent from Port Miami, Florida. The message read, January 13, 1944. My dear friends, your baby came through with flying colors. We'll give you a call upon my return. Hoping you are all well, and with best wishes, Captain Sam Houston. Your baby? I was intrigued. Not all of the artifacts in the collection have a Masonic connection. Maybe this was about a seafaring son of Mr. and Mrs. Cooker traveling on his first voyage? I went to the library's archives and searched the biography files for Morris Cooker. The biography files don't always have supporting documentation for the artifact collection items, but in this case, success. A very thin folder held two items. The first was a citation which read, "For patriotic and effective services rendered on behalf of the Fourth War Loan, this citation is awarded to Mrs. Morris Cooker by the War Finance Committee for New York, United States Treasury Department." Now, World War II expenses from 1941 to 1945 were close to $281 billion. Taxes and other sources covered close to 45% of these expenses, but the rest, over $185.7 billion, was raised by selling war bonds in eight major fundraising drives. The Fourth War Loan Drive, for which Mrs. Cooker received her citation, was held for 32 days, from June 12th to July 8th, 1944, and was targeted towards women and farmers. Its goal was to raise $14 billion, and with over 70 million bonds sold, final sales were $16.7 billion. The second item in Right Worship Cooker's biography file was a one-page hand-typed program for the presentation of the palm on Right Worship Cooker's 60th Masonic birthday. In the program's description for Right Worship Cooker's speech topic, it stated his response would be followed by the presentation in sacred memory of his late lamented wife by Right Worship Morris Cooker of the historic tokens commemorating the launching on December 4th, 1943 at Baltimore, Maryland, the American Liberty ship SS Louis Kossuth, at which patriotic function Mrs. Morris Cooker officiated as sponsor. This was the clue that I needed. The baby was the American Liberty ship the SS Lewis Kossuth. Now the question became, what does Right Worshipful Cougar have to do with a U.S. merchant marine ship? The program also mentioned that Right Worshipful Cougar's lodge was Ayler's Lodge number 953. I searched the library's microfilm records and learned that while he was raised in New York City's Maimonides Lodge number 743 in January of 1892 and was later a member of Dirigo Lodge number 30, he was, in 1917, one of the founders and charter members of Ayler's Lodge number 953, also in Manhattan. I moved then to another part of the library's archive collection, to the library's lodge historical files, to find out any further information I could about Right Worshipful Cougar, his relationship to Ayler's Lodge, and to the SS Lewis Kossuth ship. Ayler's Lodge number 953. Ayler's Lodge number 953, after mergers in 1975, 1984, 1986, and 1988, is now Joshua Lodge number 890, which is still in existence. Many of the quotes in this lecture come directly from documents within the lodge historical file. Ayler's Lodge was granted initial dispensation as Edward M. L. Ayler's Lodge on November 8, 1917. Due to the initial master named who wasn't able to serve, the lodge was granted a secondary dispensation on January 4, 1918. The charter was granted on May 8, 1918, under the name of Ayler's Lodge number 953. The lodge was formed by Masons born in Hungary and Austria, who were living in New York City and who wanted to counteract the falsity of many cruel charges, suspicions, and even assumptions about loyal Americans of Hungarian extraction who were being looked at during World War I as enemy aliens. Long before the United States formally entered World War I, people from the countries of the Central Powers came under suspicion as potential traitors and enemy agents. World War I lasted from July 1914 to November 1918 and was between the Allies, which were the Russian Empire, the French Third Republic, and the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Ireland, against the Central Powers of Germany and Austria-Hungary. On April 2, 1917, the United States President Woodrow Wilson requested from a joint session of Congress to declare war against Germany and received the Senate's support on April 4th and the House's support on April 6th. On December 7, 1917, the United States also declared war on Austria-Hungary. The name Ayler's Lodge was taken to honor the Grand Secretary and honorary past Grand Master Edward M. L. Ayler's, who as Grand Secretary served 22 Grand Masters over 36 years, and who had died exactly 1 year prior to the day the lodge was constituted. This bust in the corner is of Most Worshipful Ayler's, and it was made by the same man, Brother Gutzon Borglum, who was the sculptor who created Mount Rushmore, the presidents that are carved into the side of the mountain. Ayler's Lodge was also the outgrowth of the Danubia Society, an association of loyal Americans of Hungarian and Austrian descent in the craft who wished to demonstrate their Masonic fellowship before endeavoring to establish a lodge. The society was started a few years earlier than the founding of the lodge, for the purpose of working out a large system of Masonic charities for the benefit of war sufferers. Ayler's Lodge was set on a foundation of unselfish humanitarian principles with active charity and sympathetic understanding. It was always more than a mere meeting night lodge. It was the center about which the Lodge Brothers' activities moved. What they accomplished was history. History that immediately lifted them out of the narrow concept of the potentialities of a Masonic lodge, and won for them the approbation not only of Grand Lodge, but of international Freemasonry as well. At the founding of Ehlers Lodge, Junior Warden Cooker spoke on the theme of the flag, the American flag, and he said, "What impressed me more than any other thing at our meeting was the presentation of the stars and stripes, more than some of you who were born on this soil. We have our obligations and gratitude to the land that received us and loyalty to this great and wonderful country, the flag, and the institutions of America. It is the duty of every man, woman, and child to give all he has to this land." Morris Cooker also proposed the Ehlers Creed, which was adopted by the Lodge. The Ehlers Creed states, "Our debt to America is an eternal debt, timeless and transmutable from generation to generation, from everlasting to everlasting. A debt constant and endless, so that this country remain what it started out to be, a haven for the oppressed, a sanctuary for the persecuted, blessed home for the millions, granting liberty, justice, and opportunity for all. As we behold a land unscarred and spared from the tragic ravages of war, as we envisage a future for this beloved land more promising than any on this strife-torn earth, we highly resolve to preach and practice allegiance and devotion to our own United States of America, with unflagging service for our democratic institutions and the sacred traditions of the American way of life, in that we feel that there is not a greater privilege nor a higher honor than to serve our God, our country, and our fellow men." Ehlers Lodge was a lodge which reached out into the public sphere to be a presence on the world stage. During World War II, Ehlers Lodge was involved in the Oswego Project, whereby 1,000 refugees from 17 nationalities and 7 religious denominations were placed in a camp in Oswego, New York, to be returned to Europe immediately upon the cessation of the war. They were provided with all necessities but no freedom, not even to visit the town itself. Ehlers Lodge felt that they were guests in our country and began a national campaign for the liberalization of the restrictions of the camp and for the eventual total freedom of the inhabitants. They conferred with statesmen, senators, government agencies, hundreds of influential men in public life, and among the first contributors to the cause was Mrs. Roosevelt, Governor Dewey, and Governor Lehman. President Truman eventually, by presidential directive, permitted some responsible agencies to escort the refugees to Canada and have them re-enter the United States as immigrants. Ehlers Lodge was also the root source for Hungarian Relief Incorporated, the official relief agency sponsored by the government at the end of World War II. By the work of the Masonic aid to the Hungary Committee, thousands of people were saved from starvation, illness, and death during all that time, especially those returned from concentration camps. Morris Cooker. Well, after understanding a little bit the lodge Morris Cooker helped to found, it became more clear as to why he was involved with the merchant marine ship SS Lewis Kossuth. In Hungarian, the Cooker name means sugar, and it is pronounced Sukwar. After helping to found Ehlers Lodge, Morris Cooker served as first Junior Warden and as master in 1920, and on numerous committees over many years. He was described by one of the lodge masters as the orator, the inspirer, the creator of ideals and ideas. In the early 1920s, a group in Ehlers Lodge conceived of the idea of erecting in New York a monument to the great liberator, Lajos Kossuth, who became a Freemason during his American visit in 1852. And in 1927, Right Worshipful Cooker was appointed as a delegate to Hungary for the restoration of Freemasonry in Hungary. Due to the enthusiasm and generosity of patriotic Hungarian Americans throughout the United States, the monument was made, a statue of Lajos Kossuth by Janusz Horvej. Here it is. The unveiling on March 15, 1928, at Riverside Drive and 113th Street was indeed a glorious achievement, which is now a part of history in both countries. 500 pilgrims from Hungary arrived in New York to attend the ceremony. The mayor of the city, Jimmy Walker, a member of the Elks, appointed Morris Cooker to welcome the delegation at the harbor as guests of the city. The visitors included a number of prominent Hungarian Masons, including the late Professor Joseph Balassa, the distinguished Deputy Grand Master of the Grand Lodge of Hungary. The delegation was acclaimed and feted at Washington, D.C. and elsewhere throughout the country during their visit. On March 16th, Ehlers Lodge held a gala communication, graced by then Grand Master John A. Dutton and his staff, with other high dignitaries of the order. Never will we forget the scene. Professor Balassa, with tear-dimmed eyes and a voice trembling with emotion, made a most eloquent plea for the highest moral and spiritual aid and support on behalf of the people of his native Hungary. In response, the Grand Master presented the visitors with an autographed copy of the Holy Bible to be placed on the altar for the day of the resurrection of Hungarian Masonry, as the first milestone on the road to the material and spiritual recovery by the free and enfranchised people of Hungary. Some 25,000 people attended the unveiling of the statue. In today's Masonry, charity is the main focus, and politics is avoided, but not so in the middle of the 20th century, at least not by Ehlers Lodge. In 1937, Morris Cooker was remembered for one of Ehlers Lodge's special evenings, whereby addresses were given by the first three masters. The basic theme was best expressed by worshipful Morris Cooker in fiery and vigorous language when he asked whether organized masonry in the United States, with 3 million members, was doing its share to lighten the burdens of the people of our country. What is the true purpose of masonry, he asked, and are we using our potential strength to advocate those reforms which we profess to stand for? In 1945, word came to Ehlers Lodge that the symbolic Grand Lodge of Hungary had been reinstituted, and the lodge immediately poured overseas food, clothing, money, and moral support. In 1948, Morris Cooker was appointed as Grand Representative of the Grand Lodge of Hungary near the Grand Lodge of New York. He was the first such representative when the symbolic Grand Lodge of Hungary was reestablished, but he did not serve long, as the Hungarian Grand Lodge was again dissolved with the Russian occupation of Hungary. In 1950, Right Worshipful Cooker was lauded by Ehlers Lodge for his labor in connection with the Kossuth celebration, which marks a century since Lajos Kossuth arrived in the United States. Over 250 people attended at the Kossuth statue on Riverside Drive. And this is a picture of that event, actually. In the lodge's record of the event, it stated, "Most Worshipful Frank M. Totten placed a wreath upon the statue of Kossuth as part of a colorful ceremony in which numerous fraternal, civic, and religious groups took part. The entire ceremony was recorded by the State Department Voice of America for rebroadcast to Hungary. The reaction to the program was abroad, despite communist suppression, was excellent." About that Voice of America program, Right Worshipful Cooker later stated, "Do you think I wasted radio time denouncing the communists and calling the present rulers names? Not a bit. The Hungarian people know their government officials better than I do. I told them about America. As I, a native Hungarian, had found it. I told them about man-to-man democracy, personal freedom, liberality, and decency in American life. Democracy? Why, you young fellows who were born in America have no appreciation of your blessings. You must come from Europe, the old Central of Eastern Europe for that. In his non-Masonic life, Right Worshipful Kukor emigrated in 1884 at age 15 with his family from Hungary to the United States. And he never stopped praising the virtues of America. He was amazed that he, a native Hungarian, was able to get a free education in the public schools and to graduate from NYU Law School with honors. In 1914, at the age of 45, Morris Kukor married Miss Cora Geraldine Woodruff. Those who might recognize the name Kukor would be interested to know that Morris Kukor was uncle of the famous Hollywood producer George Kukor, who, among over 50 films he made, produced Little Women, The Philadelphia Story, A Star is Born, and My Fair Lady, working with stars such as Katharine Hepburn, Judy Garland, Marilyn Monroe, Elizabeth Taylor, Audrey Hepburn, Vivien Leigh, Greta Garbo, Cary Grant, Spencer Tracy, James Mason, Gene Kelly, William Holden, and Jack Lemmon, to name a few. During World War I, Right Worshipful Morris Kukor served as legal advisor to the United States Selective Service System and as president of the New York Civil Service Department. In World War II, he served as group chairman of the War Finance Committee of the U.S. Treasury Department. Then, within the Lodge historical files, I found the reference I had been searching for. During World War II, Morris Kukor was also chairman of the Hungarian section of the War Bond Drive, and he and his committee raised $2 million in 48 hours. Right Worshipful Kukor asked President Roosevelt for a token of recognition to the Hungarian people, and the president authorized naming a liberty ship for Louis Kossuth, the Hungarian patriot and freedom fighter. Brother Kukor was amazed that this was possible while America was enemies with Hungary, but still able to distinguish the difference within the historic figure of Lajos Kossuth and his fight for democratic rule of Hungary. The SS Louis Kossuth was built in 21 days by the Bethlehem Ship Corporation at the Bethlehem Fairfield Shipyard in Baltimore. At the time of its launching on December 4, 1943, 256 Liberty ships had been launched to that date. Liberty ships were designed for emergency construction by the U.S. Maritime Commission, and by the end of World War II, there were 2,711 that were built. Their 250,000 parts were prefabricated throughout the country in 250-ton sections and then welded together. Liberty ships were 7,176-ton steam cargo vessels, 440 feet long and 56 feet wide, and they could hold over 9,000 tons of cargo, plus airplanes, tanks, and locomotives tied to the deck. It could carry 2,840 jeeps, 440 tanks, or 230 million rounds of ammunition. Any group which raised $2 million in war bonds could suggest a name for a Liberty ship. SS Louis Kossuth was damaged on Britain's west coast on August 23, 1944, by either a German U-boat U-989 torpedo or by an acoustic mine. The accounts vary. The damaged vessel continued on the resupply mission to the Utah beachhead. The SS Louis Kossuth was scrapped in 1957, and today there are only two Liberty ships which remain as museum ships, one in San Francisco and one in Baltimore. With the discovery of Morris Kukor's request to the president to name a Liberty ship after Louis Kossuth, I had come back to the artifact collection. I had found the reason for the postcard's message. I had photographed the postcard, placed it on the online museum, and researched the biography of the donor, Right Worshipful Kukor. Now, I began to research the biography of the postcard's subject, Lajos Kossuth. Louis Lajos Kossuth. Lajos Kossuth has been called the father of Hungarian democracy. for his role in promoting and fighting for Hungarian freedom. Born in 1802, in 1831 he began practicing law and almost immediately became involved in politics, serving in 1832 as a member of the upper house of the Diet of Hungary under the Austrian Empire, which was ruled by the Habsburg dynasty. On the side, he began to edit a handwritten underground newspaper that advocated freedom from the overarching imperial Austrian government. This newspaper began as letters, since he served as a proxy in the Diet, and it was his duty to furnish his patrons with reports of the proceedings. His letters were so excellent that they were circulated among the liberal magnates and soon developed into an organized gazette, of which he was the editor. His writings aroused his countrymen to dare battle, as he wrote about the people raising themselves out of their oppression, and his spirit spread among them. A second typed newspaper that he then began to edit landed him in jail for 3 years, as the Austrian Empire decided that his criticisms of them were equivalent to treason. His jailing caused great indignation, and the liberals carried the elections for the Diet in 1839 and 1840, releasing him from jail in May of 1840. Upon his release, he continued as editor of a third paper that advocated freedom of the press, emancipation of the peasants, removal of noble privileges, and better recognition of the average citizen. In 1847, his political career continued, and he was sent as a deputy of the lower house of the Diet. In March of 1848, the Diet approved the demands of the people of Hungary, and Kossuth led a delegation of the Diet to Vienna. Emperor Ferdinand finally granted the request, and the first popular Hungarian government was constituted, with Kossuth as Minister of Finance of the cabinet of Count Bastia. Kossuth established a treasury, organized the army, the Honved, created the Hungarian war industry, and aroused the spirit of the nation with proclamations, speeches, and articles. On April 14, 1849, largely through the efforts of Kossuth, the Diet at Dzsprychkin announced the independence of Hungary. A republic was now established, and Kossuth was chosen as governor. He had hoped that England and France would recognize the independence of Hungary, but in this he was disappointed. Furthermore, Russia then invaded Hungary in the interests of the Habsburgs. The Hungarian army was defeated at the Battle of Temesvár on August 9, 1849, and 2 days later, Kossuth resigned his leadership position in favor of Gorgi, who promptly surrendered the army to the Russians. Kossuth then traveled to Turkey with about 5,000 of his men. With England and France's support, Turkey refused to surrender Kossuth to Austria and Russia. With the United States very sympathetic to the Hungarian struggle for liberty, the United States sent the steam frigate Mississippi to Turkey to rescue Kossuth from exile. Here we are. This is Lajos Kossuth leaving Turkey under the guard of the United States. From England, Kossuth took the SS Humboldt to America, landing at Staten Island in New York on December 4th, 1851. In New York, Kossuth was hugely welcomed. He then traveled around the United States, garnering support for Hungary. He had come as an official guest of the government, and he addressed the Senate and the House of Representatives in 1852. During the next 6 months, he visited more than 60 cities and gave about 300 speeches. American reception was warm, helped in part by the fact that 3 years earlier, in 1849, Abraham Lincoln, then an Illinois representative in Congress, presented a series of resolutions that read, "Resolved that in their present glorious struggle for liberty, the Hungarians command our highest admiration and have our warmest sympathy. Resolved that they have our most ardent prayers for their speedy triumph and final success. Resolved that the government of the United States should acknowledge the independence of Hungary as a nation of free men at the very earliest moment, consistent with our amicable relations with the government against which they are contesting. Resolved that in the opinion of this meeting, the immediate acknowledgement of the independence of Hungary by our government is due from American freemen to their struggling brethren, to the general cause of republican liberty, and not violative of the just rights of any nation or people. However, the Hungarian Revolution had failed. Lajos Kossuth had gone into exile and then been brought to America. While visiting Ohio, he applied to become a Mason in Cincinnati Lodge No. 133. His case was declared one of emergency, and he was unanimously elected to membership. His petition reads as follows. Being an exile, for liberty's sake, he has no place of fixed residence, is now staying in Cincinnati. His age is 49 and a half. His occupation is to restore his native land, Hungary, to its national independence, and to achieve by community of action with other nations civil and religious liberty in Europe. Lajos Kossuth was also made a member of the Cincinnati Royal Arch Chapter. Kossuth made several Masonic visitations, including one to Center Lodge No. 23 in Indianapolis on February 28, 1852, and one at the Grand Lodge of Massachusetts on May 19, 1852. Three quotes by Lajos Kossuth reflected his appreciation of Freemasonry. The first was at the Center Lodge meeting, where he said, "The Masonic Brotherhood is one of which tends to better the condition of mankind, and we are delighted to find it enlists the attention of so many brethren around you as we find surrounding us here. Besides the great antiquity of the order, which should endear it to all good Masons, its excellent precepts and high moral teachings must induce all good members of the order to appreciate its benevolent purposes and useful works. To one like myself, without a country or a home, dependent upon the hospitality of strangers for life and protection, a great substitution for all my privations is, I find, to be surrounded by brethren of the Masonic order." The second quote is from March 3, 1852, in St. Louis, Missouri, where he said, "Oh, if all men were Freemasons, what a worldwide and glorious republic we should have." And the third quote is from his visit to the Grand Lodge in Massachusetts, where he said, "I am one of the humblest brethren among you, an exile from a distant land, but the great attention bestowed upon me by the citizens of your magnificent country I attribute to the generous sympathy in the sufferings of my people. Most worshipful Grand Master and brethren, rest assured it will be the great aim and effort of my life to walk worthy of the character of a Mason, to fulfill the duties which devolve, according to his ability and rank, upon every member of our noble institution." In July of 1852, Kossuth returned to England and lived there for 10 years. In 1862, he moved to Turin, Italy, where he lived until his death on March 20, 1894. In 1867, though, after Hungary and Austria were reconciled, he was elected to the Hungarian Diet, but he refused the honor because Austria still had the power to annul any laws the Diet enacted. Kossuth lived his last years in poverty, refusing any help from his many friends. The Hungarian government allowed him to be buried in Budapest on March 27, 1894, amid the mourning of the entire country. In 1932, to honor Lajos Kossuth, A lodge was formed in New York City called Lewis Kossuth Lodge number 1117, receiving its charter in 1934. In 1968, this lodge merged with Arcana Lodge number 246, a lodge still in existence in the 7th Manhattan District. Finishing up the biography of Lasdon Kossuth and linking it to the postcard with his image in the online virtual museum, I thought, now I have finished all the work needed to understand the connection between the message on the postcard, Right Worshipful Morris Cooker, Brother Lasdon Kossuth, and all of that's reflection in our artifact collection. This one postcard, among thousands, had brought to light an important figure in Masonic history, as well as highlighting the struggle for freedom in Hungary and the efforts of the Masonic Brethren of Hungarian descent here in New York. This was in 2006. I rehoused the postcard in an archival sheath, and I turned to something else in the collection. However, within the artifact collection, there's a set of material in Hungarian about which I knew nothing, because I don't read or speak Hungarian. In 2014, a patron came to visit the library and museum and introduced himself as Edward Brody, a brother studying law here in New York City. I said, oh, I have a friend with the same last name who is Hungarian. He replied that he was Hungarian as well. And I said, well, perhaps you'd be interested in some material we have in our collection about which I don't know too much. I brought out the documents, and upon seeing one of them, this letter right here, he lost all the blood in his face. And he said, do you realize what this is? I said, no. He told me the material was related to Lasdon Kossuth, and this letter was handwritten by Lasdon Kossuth when he was in Turkey, imprisoned, right before the American ship came to pick him up. This period of time of his life has been obscured. There's not a lot of records. In the letter, he discusses his failed attempt when he came to Turkey with his 5,000 soldiers to create in Turkey a haven for Hungarians fleeing oppression in Hungary. And in the letter, he discussed the reasons he believed caused that failure. Additional documents in the set are likewise very historically important, including an 1851 list of names in the Constantinople Hungarian Society, which began in 1851 and was dissolved in 1857. Brother Brody volunteered to come to the library 1 hour a week, which was the only time he could spare during his studies, and he translated all the documents that we have over the course of about a year and a half. With his translations, I made an exhibit focused on Lasdon Kossuth in 2015. Now, I thought, this is the end of the story as reflected in our artifact collection. But it wasn't. Last year, I came across a single piece of paper which reflected a loan our library had made on May 28, 2000. The paper said it was a loan of a christening bottle and case. And I thought, that's odd. Masons don't do christenings, so far as I know, but maybe one of the past grand chaplains was involved. Then I noticed it had been loaned to the Westchester County Veterans Museum at Lasdon Park in Katona, New York. And I thought, no, it couldn't be the christening bottle of the SS Lewis Kossuth. I had posted in Morris Cooker's online biography the photograph of the SS Lewis Kossuth, including an image of him shaking the hand of the captain with Mrs. Cooker holding a christening bottle wrapped with striped ribbons. I called the Lasdon Park Memorial, a veterans memorial, and I spoke with Ted Kozlowski, the name given to me as one who could answer my questions about the loan. After several weeks of playing phone tag, we finally spoke, and I asked him about the christening bottle and case. He went to go look in their storeroom and told me that, yes, they had a box with a bag filled with broken glass inside, And yes, it was related to the SS Lewis Kossuth. I asked for the return of the loan. He agreed, but he said he didn't feel comfortable shipping it since it was already broken glass. I envisioned a battered box and a nondistinct bag filled with broken glass. I still wanted it back. After several months, we arranged to have the Grand Lodge of New York's Grand Treasurer, Right Worshipful Peter A. Flynn III, pick up the box and deliver it back to us, as he lives in that area of the Lasdon Park Museum. When I saw the case, it wasn't battered. It was a beautifully crafted box with a silver plate on the top, engraved with various fonts with Christening Bottle, SS Lewis Kossuth, launched December 4th, 1943, Mrs. Morris Cooker, sponsor. It truly is a curator's dream come true. Now 73 years old and 17 years out of the possession of the Grand Lodge, whereby within our archives was a photograph of the bottle before it was broken, the bottle has made its way home. Well, in our photograph collection, there were a few photographs of the christening day of the SS Lewis Kossuth, which I included in Morris Cooker's online biography. With the return of the christening bottle came a photocopy of a letter from President and Masonic brother Franklin Delano Roosevelt, with many signatures on the back, as well as numerous additional photographs related to the whole story. He was not able to attend the christening. Two of these photographs shed further light on yet four other artifacts in our collection. One photograph showed a man opening a small box for Mrs. Cooker's examination, and I gasped. I knew that box. I had worked on it years earlier. It was a green leather box with a gold-toned plate and a note inside, which had no context and which had made no sense to me. I went to find it, and now the plate and the note it contained made sense, and the reason for its presence in the artifact collection understood. The plate reads, "Presented to Mrs. Morris Cooker, sponsor, SS Lewis Kossuth, 4th of December, 1943, by Bethlehem Fairfield Shipyard, Incorporated." The note inside reads, "Herein was contained the ornamental christening pin, the sponsor's inseparable and beloved companion and talisman." Also within the photographs, returned with the christening bottle, was a photograph of 10 men, also on display here, which you can see after the lecture. In that photograph with the 10 men, they were holding three framed objects. One is a shadow box filled with medals. One is a print titled "When Kossuth Rode Up Broadway," and one is a portrait of Lajos Kossuth, the same as the identical postcard which started my discovery of this story. Two of those items are on display here tonight, with the medals still in need of research and identification. Who knows what stories they will reveal about Masonry, and about New York history, and about world history. In just one photograph, just one postcard, the background of numerous items in the collection has been identified, with several other connected artifacts, possibly in our collections, yet to be located. This collection of artifacts is a continual exploration of discovery, and it is my joy and my honor to bring these artifacts and their meaning back into the light. Thank you. Thank you.